is Cyndi, and this is March's Inspiration from the Greats. And this month we're going to do Henri Rousseau. I'm trying to use my French accent, Henri, instead of saying Henry. Anyway, he was born in 1844, died in 1910, and his artistic style was called naive. And I didn't even know that was an artistic style. I think mine is naive too. I don't know. Anyway, yeah, they called it naive. He wasn't really loved by a lot of the other artists of the time because he wasn't professionally trained. So they didn't have a whole lot of respect for him, even though he did have a lot of friends that were famous artists, like Picasso and a couple other ones. Anyway, he did a lot of jungle scenes, and that's what I'm going to try to do this month. And of course, he painted his jungle scenes. My initial thought was to do a collage, but now I've changed my mind. I think what I'm going to do, I've got an 11 by 15 piece of watercolor paper here, and I think I'm going to draw a jungle scene with a pencil, probably go over it with a black pen, then I'm going to color it in, and I'm not sure if I'm going to use, I could use watercolors, I could use, I have these Sakura watercolor markers, and then I have Faber-Castell markers. I'm not quite sure what I'm going to color it in with yet. But I figure I'll just start by seeing if I can draw something Rousseau-esque and take it from there. So I'll be back in just a minute. Okay, I've been thinking about it a little bit, and I think what I'm going to do first is put a little wash, a watercolor wash on the background before I start drawing, to get some color on there. And so I've read a little bit about, right now I'm just putting water on, Rousseau, and he came from a very poor family, like most people back then did, seems. He worked a regular sort of like government job. He was having problems with the whole talking and doing this thing. Anyway, he worked at I think the building is still standing. He worked at, it was sort of like a toll booth, but any goods coming in or out of town had to go through him and had to, I guess, pay a tax. And he was, you know, sort of like the tax collector. So he wasn't, you know, really liked. And he was married. He had, I think, 8 children. 7 of them died. I think he had one that lived into adulthood. So that's pretty tragic. Then when he was in his 40s, his wife, I think her name was, Clemence, something like that. She passed away, and then he retired and received a pension, from the government. Now, all this time, while he was working his regular 9-to-5 job, he was, you know, what they called a Sunday painter. He always painted, but it was just a hobby. I mean, he loved it. He always wanted to be a painter, but he had to be responsible because he was married and had children. So when he retired and his wife had died, he packed up and moved to Paris, I believe, somewhere in France. I believe it was Paris, and considered himself a painter, built his studio, and just started painting, and He tried to get into a lot of the galleries. He was always trying to get into the Louvre, but he wasn't able to. They didn't like him. You know, he wasn't trained, so they sort of looked down upon him. He did develop friendships with, look at this running up here. He developed friendships with some of the other artists of that time. Well, I'm gonna let that go because I'm gonna have trees everywhere, so I'm not totally bummed that the green's up here. Is this green? Yes, it is. But he developed friendships, although a lot of them, you know, a lot of people made fun of him because they considered his artwork naive. But he would not be deterred. He just kept trying, and he made friends with all the people in the town, and he would, you know, paint murals on the outsides of their buildings. And they, you know, he seemed like a very innocent type person. He never traveled anywhere, but he had such an imagination, and that's why they say he did all of the jungle scenes and all of these tropical scenes, because he dreamt of exotic places, but he never went anywhere. I think he used to tell people that he had been to these places. He used to tell people that he'd been to Mexico and different places, but in reality, he had never traveled. Okay. I think all I wanted to do is just get some color on here so that I wouldn't have to cover every single inch with my drawing, which I'm still sort of at odds with in my mind. I'm not exactly sure how I'm going to do it. But while this is drying, I'll think about it. All right? I want this green to come up a little higher, and maybe I'm gonna dab some more blue up in here. Let's get some more blue. Get some more blue. Whoa, maybe a little too much blue, but this is probably gonna dry lighter anyway. All right, so I'm gonna let this dry, and then we'll go from there. I'll be right back. All right, I'm gonna get started, and I changed my whole thought process on this. I'm going to use colored pencils, and I have my very favorite colored pencils, Prismacolor. I also have some ink tints pencils. These are water soluble, so I'm not sure, but I may bring some of these in and then use my water brush or a wet brush. We'll see how it goes. I did a fairly detailed sketch, and I did this off camera because I knew it was going to take a long time and I didn't want to bore you to death, but what I did, I just drew some trees, some palm trees, and a lot of greenery, some mountains in the background, and I'm not sure how I'm going to do these mountains. those may stay watercolor. I don't know. This is a tough one. This is a tough one for me, but I'm going to start coloring. I was going to use the black pen and just outline everything, but I don't know, that seemed a little whack, so I'm going to try this, and we will see how it goes. Plus, I'll be practicing a little bit with the colored pencils, because I am working on a coloring book, and even though I will probably pay somebody else to color it for me, for the cover and the back cover, because I'm not a good colorer. But I don't know. If I enjoy this, maybe I'll do it myself. I don't know. We may have to fast forward at some point too, because a lot of this is going to be repetitive and I don't want to bore you to death with this. But as I mentioned earlier, Henri Rousseau painted his pieces of art. They've been used a lot in children's books, and I think some very Rousseau-esque things have been used in children's animated movies. His colors were very, you know, bright, and just the whole tropical scene and animals. He was really into animals like tigers and elephants, gorillas. He would, as I mentioned before, he never traveled to any of these tropical places, but he would go to the museum and look at the stuffed animals. Like they have, I can imagine, like at the, or I would imagine that they're like at the Smithsonian, if you've ever been to the Smithsonian. They have a lot of stuffed animals there. I used to go there a lot as a kid. And I loved that big elephant. I think they still have it there. It's a huge elephant when you walk into the Museum of Natural History. And then they also had this gigantic Bengal tiger with a little plaque that said that when they caught this tiger, it had just eaten a person, which I find very sad and distressing now, but as a child I found that very interesting. Anyway, but he liked to look at these animals, and he would take his sketchbook or whatever he used, and he would sit there and draw and paint. You know, he was friends with Picasso, and the way Picasso met him was this guy, like a street vendor type person, a junk man, was going down the street with his cart of junk, and he had one of Rousseau's paintings, which he thought was just junk, and he told Picasso, "Hey, I've got, you know, a canvas here that you could use, you know, you could paint over it." So evidently Picasso did the same thing that Cyndi does. I paint over previously used canvases to save a little money. So I guess Picasso was a money saver too, but this vendor guy knew that. And so he took it to Picasso to sell it to him, you know, as just something he could paint over. But Picasso kind of liked it, even though it was different. He looked at it as being very amateurish. But, you know, he liked the colors and blah, blah, blah. So he met Rousseau and they became friends, even though it was kind of a... God, I hope I'm on camera. Yeah, I think I am. Kind of a whack friendship, because it doesn't sound like Picasso was really that nice to Rousseau, Picasso, and the other artists, because they used to like screw with him all the time. They do all kinds of things to make fun of him. Like one time they held this like banquet, and they told him that he had won some big award or something, or they were, he had been accepted to the Louvre. And then they told him, you know, midway through, ah, this is just a joke. I mean, he was all, you know, excited. This is what he'd been wanting all of his life. And, you know, he's thrilled. Then they say, you know, ha ha, we're just kidding. You're a fool. You're never going to get accepted. I mean, that seems like a pretty whack thing to do. And an especially mean thing to do to a friend. But they like to do those kind of things to him. And I guess he was just sort of an easygoing good guy and dealt with it in hopes that someday his dreams would come true. He submitted his artwork every year to the Louvre. That's a really hard word for me to say. And you people out there, if any of you are speak French, you'll get a real kick out of me struggling to say that. But yeah, you know, every year he'd haul his stuff in there and show it, and every year he would be turned down. Because they were just into, you know, people that were trained in just a certain type of, a more sophisticated type of art at that time. And they just didn't think that that was him. Little did they know that he would become famous, of course, like most of them. He became well known after he died. Now, he is one of the, he's the first artist that I'm doing in Inspiration from the Greats that didn't take his own life. So that's good. But he ended up selling a painting and getting a good bit of money for it. And it was acknowledged by, I guess, the experts right before he died. This happened, and then just like a couple months later, he ended up getting an infection. I think he injured his leg. And it became infected, and he had a little surgery, and then he died. So that's a bummer, especially since, you know, his entire life, his dream was to be an artist. But he didn't do, you know, what a lot of people did and just forsake everything else and go after his dream. You know, like I mentioned earlier, he was married, he had children, and he held the 9-to-5 job up until he retired so that he could be responsible to his family and the children that he kept having. 8 kids. And only one of them, only one, lived to be an adult. I guess that was fairly common back then, but that's a bummer. That's pretty sad. And these Prismacolor pencils, you know, you can put them on like this. Like you would a colored pencil, but then you can take you can either use a white pencil or what they call a blender pencil, and I don't have one right here. You can go over it and it really, well, this white doesn't work too well over the green, actually, over red, it works really well. This white is actually lightening it. But if you use it over red, it really doesn't lighten the color at all. But it makes it look like, almost like oil paint. It's beautiful. It's really smooth, and you can't tell that it's a pencil at all. It's beautiful. But, and you can layer them. So you can create a lot of nice shading and highlights. They're really, really beautiful color pencils. But as you can see, this is going to take a long time because I have a lot of leaves. Sorry about that. That's crazy. Yeah, I live in the country. That is my next door neighbor, and I don't know what he has just purchased. I'm assuming that that's a motorcycle, but I don't know. Is it some kind of like all-terrain vehicle, or I don't know what it is. But he just got it a couple weeks ago. And he's up and down the street constantly with that thing. And he loves to do it whenever I'm recording. It's so rude of him. So, so rude. Okay. So I think I'm going to go ahead and fast forward this for a little while. Then I'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about Henri. And see what I'm going to do from there. Okay, I'll put on some music. Thank you. Okay, this is what I have so far. I was working on it last night in front of the TV because this is very time consuming, as you can imagine, with all these tiny little leaves. And I just started doing my palm tree trunk and realized that's not the way palm trees are. Palm trees are smooth and then they get this rough texture right at the top. So I'm going to change the way I'm doing that. And there's sort of a, do I have an eraser? Yeah, in fact, let me erase what I haven't already colored in. Sort of a grayish, like a grayish brown at the bottom. If I can gray this out a little bit. In fact, that's kind of like the color right there. Similar. So maybe I'll put a little brown in here and then go over it with gray. And then add some texture at the top. I totally forgot what coconuts look like. I think that when they're they have sort of a rough texture on them. So after I get everything colored in the way I like it, I'm going to go over it with the blending pencil. Try to smooth it out a little bit so it'll look more like paint. Here we go. Let's do some of this at the top. Now, this looks really weird because I've got it at the bottom, not at the top. But maybe I can do something with that, with the blending thingy. Let's see. I've got another little palm tree trunk right here. Another little one right here. And another little one right here. And this gray is really like a creamy type pencil. It's almost like a crayon. Hold on, my husband's calling me. Okay, I'm back. Let's see, I need to add some green up in here so it doesn't look like my coconuts are just floating. I'm not attached to anything. Add some around there. Add some around here. Yeah, maybe a little bit in here. Now, I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do these mountains. In fact, I might look at some pictures of Rousseau's mountains. Let's see. Let me do some. Let's put in, I've got a few flowers here. So let's color those in. Pink. That looks pretty. I love the pinks and purples that Prismacolor has. They're pretty vibrant. I just went outside and my irises are blooming. We had a friend give us some irises a couple years ago, and we planted them and they didn't bloom, and he told us that they would take a while to, they're slow growing. And then he gave us another really big iris plant. It's probably about 4 feet in diameter, and we planted that just a couple days ago. And all of them, the old ones and the new one, started blooming yesterday, and they are beautiful, beautiful white irises with little bits of blue and purple. And I took some pictures, and I want to try to paint them. They'd be beautiful if I could watercolor them, but I don't know. I don't know if I'm brave enough to try that. Maybe I am. Okay, so we have some flowers there. Now this is a waterfall coming down through here. So I'm going to take a look at how Rousseau does his mountains. And I definitely don't want to be filling them all in with these kind of leaves, really, really tiny, because I really don't have that kind of time on my hands. No, actually, I do have that kind of time on my hands. I don't have that kind of patience. I'm trying to use my white here as my blending pencil. And it does make it look like paint, but it's lightening it up a lot. So I want to try to find my actual blending pencil. Okay, so I'll be right back. And of course, I could not find anything. All of his were just full of leaves and palm fronds and things like that. So I'm just going to color mine in the way I would imagine he would have colored his in. And I'll start by just doing my water blue, and then I'll try to put some white on top of it to make it look, you know, watery. I did find some other paintings that I wish that I had seen before, because I would have liked to have tried that. Of course, I still can. Okay, the water, of course, would just be coming across straight here, right? Right? I guess. I could be just ruining my whole picture now. But it is what it is, and his did look kind of childlike, and that's why they called his artwork, his style, naive, I guess. Okay. So I'm just going to make my mountains, sort of outline them, and then they're all going to be just sort of bluish, brownish, greenish. Because these are way in the distance, and I notice on most of his paintings, everything was, he didn't go that far into the distance, so. So, just just have to use my imagination. It would probably be easier if I went in with some more watercolor, but I don't know that I can really do that now that I have all this colored pencil down. I don't know how the watercolor would react to the colored pencil, and I'm afraid to try it. Okay, let's go. Some brown. Way up here. Probably go through about three or four of those blending tools. I think actually I have two of them. Two of the blending pencils. Okay, there we can sort of see our mountains there. And then I did some sort of little rocky type formations here. Okay. What am I gonna do? What am I gonna do? Don't know. I'll put down some blue and then put some green over it. You guys are probably watching me do that thinking, why doesn't she just do this? And, yeah, I wish you could call me and tell me right now. Tell me what to do. hopefully next month my Frida Kahlo will be a little better. A little easier, a little more thought out before I do it. Yeah, so back to more about Rousseau. You know, he seemed like such, you know, a nice sort of innocent type guy, but there is a story in the book about him being in jail. He was in jail for a little while because he got involved in sort of like an embezzlement scheme with someone he knew, and he forged some checks and ended up in jail, but he got out because of, you know, he didn't have a record, and he had a long time working for the government, so he didn't have to do hard time over it, but he wasn't like a totally, wasn't totally a goody two-shoes. And he did get married again. He was married while he was, after he retired, while he was pursuing his art career. And she was very supportive of his art and helped him sell it, try to sell it. And he would trade his art for things that they needed. Okay, this is kind of cool. This isn't looking bad with the green on top of the blue. I'm liking that. It's ending up a little bit better than I thought it would be. See, you just never know. You just never know. You have to keep going. What is this? Is this the blue that I was using, or was I using indigo? I think I was using... I don't know which one I was using. Okay. I think I was using this one. I'm gonna mention this. I put a thing on, I shared a link on my Facebook, and I think I put it on my, I did not put it on the Inspiration from the Greats group, but I did put it on my Mixed Media Passion and my personal Facebook, and it's a link that my sister shared. She belongs to a breast cancer support group. It's like a national organization. And she was chosen, they put out a calendar every year, and she was chosen to be one of the calendar girls for 2018. And she's very happy about that. My sister has stage 4 breast cancer. And this group has been very helpful to her, and she's enjoyed being able to be supportive to other people through the group. But anyway, she's gonna be in the calendar for 2018, and she has committed to do fundraising for the group. And so I put up a link. Where am I still on camera? Oh man, I'm off camera, aren't I? I'm sorry. She put up a link. I put up a link. I put up her link where people could go to donate to this breast cancer support group. So, if you're interested, check out the link and, you know, think about making a donation. And I noticed that in the donation section, they start the donations at $50, but there's a space right under it where you can write in any amount. It doesn't have to, you know, be a minimum of $50. It can be anything. But I wanted to point that out because it sort of makes it look like when you go there that you have to donate at least $50, which, you know, would be a little steep for a lot of people. But yeah, my sister is like amazed by how many young women have breast cancer. I mean, my sister is 50. What am I? I'm going to be 57. So she is going to be 53 next month. But she sees women all the time in their 30s and 40s and even 20s that are getting breast cancer. I mean, it's just incredible. You don't think about women that young developing breast cancer, but they sure do. And it's just awful because a lot of these women have young children. And they're dealing with, you know, probably the most difficult thing they'll have to deal with in their life. And they also have young children that they have to care for and worry about. So they have the added stress at a time when you really don't need any kind of added stress. You know, it's pretty bad. Of course, you know, since my sister has breast cancer, we've talked about it a lot. And, you know, you may not agree, but it just seems to me, and to a lot of people, that, you know, this has to be environmental in some way. There's something that, you know, we are breathing or eating or drinking or whatever that's causing all of this cancer. And cancer in people that, you know, are so young. I mean, yeah, there have always been young people that have gotten cancer, but it just seems like there's so many more now. So much more prevalent. And my sister was never, she didn't smoke or drink or go out into the sun. I mean, she is nothing like me. You know, she didn't have, you know, any vices. And she was an RN, or yeah, she is an RN, although she had to retire recently. But so she always, you know, was very concerned and careful about her health and about, you know, germs and things that are bad for you. And, you know, just a lot more careful than I've ever been. So she didn't have a lot of the things that would normally make a person at risk. So, who knows what it is, but they definitely need, you know, money for research, to get to the bottom of this, and to come up with some, you know, different treatments. They always say, oh, you know, if you ask an oncologist, if you say, you know, why haven't they come up with a cure for cancer? The oncologist will say, well, we have. It's chemo and radiation. But you would think that they could come up with something better, because that the chemo and radiation really takes a toll on you. I forgot this little flower down here. It really takes a toll on you in a lot of ways. You know, weakens your immune system. You have to be very careful about where you go, your environment, environment, easy for me to say. Can't eat certain foods. You know, the treatment, even though, you know, it does save a lot of lives, it also changes your life in a lot of ways. Okay, now let's put some, maybe I'll do this back. It's gonna be brown, but I think I'm gonna add a little purple in it too. Maybe, Maybe not. Does this remind you of something that you would draw as a child? Ooh, which reminds me. I just picked up my, I may have mentioned before that I'm working on a coloring book. And I've finished most of the drawings. And I just took them to the copy place to have them scanned because my scanner doesn't work. And I wanted to get good scans to be able to upload them to the place to do the self-publishing. So, I haven't looked at them yet because I'm still waiting for my Art Journal Jazz video to upload to YouTube. It's been uploading now for, I'd say about 20 hours. Man, when you do a video over an hour, it takes forever. Like this one. This one's gonna take forever. Upload. I usually let it go overnight, which I did last night, but it's still going. Still going. But as soon as that happens, I want to check out my see how the scans turned out. And decide whether I want to color a few of them for the cover or pay someone else to do it. When I look at, I guess it'll probably all depend on how this turns out. Because I don't know if I want to do it with colored pencils or with markers. I need to look at some other coloring book covers. You know, I want it to look nice. Let's see, I said I was going to add in some purple. Let's see. Let's see here. Ooh, that's kind of cool. I like that. Yeah, I like that. Instead of having just totally poopy brown. Okay, I think I'll take some dark blue in here. And I'm gonna go ahead and speed this up while I do this. And then put some white in here. And then I'll come back. Thank you. find my blending pencils. Looked everywhere. I can picture what they look like. It's two little pencils. They're in a long plastic bag and it says blending pencils on them. Nope, can't find them. So I'm gonna have to use a white pencil. And the white pencil actually works about the same. And a lot of colored pencil artists use a white pencil to blend their colored pencils. So that's what I'm gonna do. And as you can see, this is gonna take a long time, but it really makes a difference. And you can see, unblended, blended. And it just gives it, you know, it's kind of an interesting look. So I'm going to blend these larger areas and some of the leaves, not all of the leaves, but some places. I hear my husband down there. He's talking on the phone. Anyway, so I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna speed it up for a while and then I might just turn off the camera because obviously this is pretty repetitive. So I'll put on some music. Some of them I did, some of them I didn't. I liked the way they looked, but I'm gonna call it finished. That's it. That's my Henri Rousseau inspired colored pencil drawing. So next month we'll do Frida Kahlo, and I'm really looking forward to that. Until then, peace.